got allergies? Even if your allergies are to the pollen outdoors, this is why you should be thinking about the foods that you're eating. Hi, I'm Dr. Chris Masterjohn of ChrisMasterjohnPhD.com, and this is Chris Masterjohn Lite, where the name of the game is details, schmeetails, just tell me what works. And today we're going to talk about why what you're eating might be impacting your seasonal allergies. A little story first. At the beginning of this summer, my allergies started acting up more than they have been in years. And why that might be the case is a different story. But they were. One of the things that I'd been playing around with in my diet at that time was the milk protein casein. For totally independent reasons, I had found that whenever I took casein out of my diet, although whey protein had no impact, whenever I took foods that contained casein, like cheese, milk, yogurt, etc., whenever I took casein out of my diet, my weight would drop 2 pounds. And whenever I would put it back into my diet, it would go up 2 pounds, up and down like clockwork every time I put it in or took it out. And that made me think maybe there's an inflammatory process going on here that's causing me to retain water. One of the things that I noticed was that my allergies seemed to get better when I'd take the casein out of my diet, although they had been by no means disappearing. So I thought, maybe if I run with this theory that the background level of inflammation is contributing to my response to pollen, that I should look for other things that I might be doing or eating that could be impacting my background level of inflammation. Now, when you get allergies in response to pollen, what's causing the allergic reaction is histamine. And that's why when you take over-the-counter allergy drugs, you're taking antihistamines. So I thought, well, what might be contributing to the amount of histamine in my body? And the obvious thing to look at was histamine in foods, because foods can contain histamine. And the foods that contain the most histamine are foods that have been fermented or aged or cured. So whether that's kimchi or sauerkraut or kombucha or even to some degree yogurt, but especially cheese, aged and cured meats, and so on, all of these foods can do contain histamine. And so I started thinking of this as a histamine bucket. If the foods are putting histamine in, maybe if it's just the foods, I don't have any reaction. Maybe putting casein into the bucket is causing a little bit of an allergic reaction somewhere that doesn't by itself cause any problems, but it raises the histamine level in the bucket. Well, if I go outdoors into the pollen and that bucket is 3/4 full, that pollen coming in might be the thing that provokes histamine enough to overfill the bucket and cause the allergic reaction. Whereas if I take out the casein, I take out the histamine in foods, and I bring that background level of histamine down close to zero, and I go outdoors with an empty bucket, then the pollen puts a little histamine in the bucket, but it doesn't do anything. So lo and behold, simply by removing the histamine from my diet, actually not completely removing the histamine from my diet, just removing the fermented foods that I'd been eating 1 or 2 tablespoons of at each meal, simply by removing those after I removed the casein, my seasonal allergies disappeared. So what can we learn from this? Well, I think the theory is very sound that what you're responding to is the total amount of histamine. And so the way that you, so anything that should reduce your background level of histamine should reduce the degree to which you react to pollen outdoors. So what are the things that you can look at? Well, the number one thing to look at is histamine in foods. Again, that's anything that's fermented, aged, or cured. There are some other foods that contain that are not aged or cured that contain moderate amounts of histamine. If you Google histamine in foods or high histamine foods, you'll get a more complete list than what I'm giving you in this episode. Removing those foods should be the number one target because those put histamine in the bucket for anyone. You, me, doesn't matter. Then the next level is is there anything that I specifically or you specifically respond to with it, with inflammation? And those things can be individual, and we don't really know what they are, and it takes some trial and error. You could look at the foods that people are most often allergic to as common culprits, like milk products, egg products, soy, tree nuts. If you look at those first, you can trial and error your way through it and see if you need to remove them. But hopefully removing histamine at first did the trick and you don't need to go that far. Now, I don't want to suggest that the solution to seasonal allergies is a restrictive diet. But if you're in the middle of an allergic reaction and you want to feel better in the instant, that may be the quickest solution. In future episodes, I'll talk more about what you can do to kind of fix the problem at its roots and become less reactive to pollen and other sources of allergic reactions. The audio of this episode was enhanced and post-processed by Bob Devodian of Torian Mixing. You can find more of his work at torianonlinemixing.com. This episode is brought to you by Testing Nutritional Status, the ultimate cheat sheet. Everything you could ever need to know to optimize your nutrition, all in one place. Easier to find and use than ever before. Get your copy at chrismasterjohnphd.com/cheat sheet. Use the code LITE5 to get $5 off. That's all capitals, LITE, and the number 5, LITE5, to get $5 off. This episode is also brought to you by Ancestral Supplements. Our Native American ancestors believed that eating the organs from a healthy animal would support the health of the corresponding organ of the individual. Ancestral Supplements has a nose-to-tail product line of grass-fed liver, organs, bone marrow, and more, in the convenience of a capsule. For more information or to buy any of their products, go to ancestralsupplements.com. All right, I hope you found this useful. Signing off, this is Chris Masterjohn of chrismasterjohnphd.com. This has been Chris Masterjohn Lite, and I will see you in the next episode.